A Millionaire of Rough and Ready. By Bret Harte. Podcast 3 of 3. Chapter 5. The apartment he entered was really only a lumber room or loft over the wing of the house, which had been left bare and unfinished, and which revealed in its meager skeleton of beams and joints the hollow sham of the whole structure. But in more violent contrast to the fresher glories of the other part of the house were its contents, which were the heterogeneous collection of old furniture, old luggage, and cast-off clothing, left over from the past life in the old cabin. It was a much plainer record of the simple beginnings of the family than Mrs. Mulratty cared to have remain in evidence, and for that reason it had been relegated to the hidden recesses of the new house, in the hope that it might absorb or digest it. There were old cribs, in which the infant limbs of Mamie and Abner had been tucked up, old looking glasses, that had reflected their shining, soapy faces, and Mamie's best chip Sunday hat, an old sewing machine, that had been worn out in active service, old patchwork quilts, an old accordion, to whose long-drawn inspirations Mamie had sung hymns, old pictures, books, and old toys. There were one or two old chromos, and, stuck in an old frame, a colored print from the Illustrated London News of a Christmas gathering in an old English country house. He stopped and picked up this print, which he had often seen before, gazing at it with a new and singular interest. He wondered if Mamie had seen anything of this kind in England, and why couldn't he have had something like it here, in their own fine house, with themselves and a few friends. He remembered a past Christmas, when he had bought Mamie that now headless doll with the few coins that were left him after buying their frugal Christmas dinner. There was an old spotted hobby horse that another Christmas had brought to Abner, who would be driving a fast trotter tomorrow at the Springs. How everything had changed. How they all had got up in the world, and how far beyond this kind of thing, and yet it would have been rather comfortable to have all been together again here. Would they have been more comfortable? No. Yet then he might have had something to do, and been less lonely tomorrow. What of that? He had something to do, to look after this immense fortune. What more could a man want, or should he want? It was rather mean in him, able to give his wife and children everything they wanted, to be wanting anything more. He laid down the print gently, after dusting its glass and frame with his silk handkerchief, and slowly left the room. The drum beat of the rain followed him down the staircase, but he shut it out with his other thoughts, when he again closed the door of his office. He set diligently to work by the declining winter light, until he was interrupted by the entrance of his Chinese waiter to tell him that supper, which was the meal that Mulratty religiously adhered to in place of the late dinner of civilization, was ready in the dining room. Mulratty mechanically obeyed the summons, but on entering the room the oasis of a few plates in a desert of white tablecloth which awaited him made him hesitate. In its best aspect, the high dark Gothic mahogany ecclesiastical sideboard and chairs of this room, which looked like the appointments of a mortuary chapel, were not exhilarating, and today, in the light of the rain-filmed windows and the feeble rays of a lamp half obscured by the dark shining walls, it was most depressing. "You can take up supper into my office," said Mulratty, with a sudden inspiration. "I'll eat it there." He ate it there, with his usual healthy appetite, which did not require even the stimulation of company. He had just finished, when his Irish cook, the one female servant of the house, came to ask permission to be absent that evening and the next day. "I suppose the likes of your honor won't be at home on the Christmas day? And it's me cousins from the old country at Rough and Ready that are inviting me. Why don't you ask them over here?" said Mulratty, with another vague inspiration. "I'll stand treat. Lord preserve you for a generous gentleman. But it's the likes of them and myself that wouldn't be at home here on such a day." There was so much truth in this that Mulratty checked a sigh as he gave the required permission, without saying that he had intended to remain. He could cook his own breakfast, he had done it before, and it would be something to occupy him. As to his dinner, perhaps he could go to the hotel at Rough and Ready. He worked on until the night had well advanced. Then, overcome with a certain restlessness that disturbed him, he was forced to put his books and papers away. It had begun to blow in fitful gusts, and occasionally the rain was driven softly across the panes like the passing of childish fingers. This disturbed him more than the monotony of silence, for he was not a nervous man. He seldom read a book, and the county paper furnished him only the financial and mercantile news which was part of his business. He knew he could not sleep if he went to bed. At last he rose, opened the window, and looked out from pure idleness of occupation. A splash of wheels in the distant muddy road and fragments of a drunken song showed signs of an early wandering reveller. There were no lights to be seen at the closed works, a profound darkness encompassed the house, as if the distant pines in the hollow had moved up and round it. The silence was broken now only by the occasional sighing of wind and rain. It was not an inviting night for a perfunctory walk, but an idea struck him: he would call upon the Slins, and anticipate his next day's visit. They would probably have company, and be glad to see him. He could tell the girls of Mamie and her success. That he had not thought of this before was a proof of his usual self-contained isolation; that he thought of it now was an equal proof that he was becoming at last accessible to loneliness. He was angry with himself for what seemed to him a selfish weakness. He returned to his office, and, putting the envelope that had been lying on Slynn's desk in his pocket, threw a serape over his shoulders, and locked the front door of the house behind him. It was well that the way was a familiar one to him, and that his feet instinctively found the trail, for the night was very dark. At times he was warned only by the gurgling of water of little rivulets that descended the hill and crossed his path. Without the slightest fear, and with neither imagination nor sensitiveness, he recalled how, the winter before, one of Don Caesar's vaqueros, crossing this hill at night, had fallen down the chasm of a landslip caused by the rain, and was found the next morning with his neck broken in the gully. Don Caesar had to take care of the man's family. Suppose such an accident should happen to him? Well, he had made his will. His wife and children would be provided for, and the work of the mine would go on all the same. He had arranged for that. Would anybody miss him? Would his wife, or his son, or his daughter? No. He felt such a sudden and overwhelming conviction of the truth of this that he stopped as suddenly as if the chasm had opened before him. No. It was the truth. If he were to disappear forever in the darkness of the Christmas night, there was none to feel his loss. His wife would take care of Mamie, his son would take care of himself, as he had before relieved of even the scant paternal authority he rebelled against. A more imaginative man than Mulready would have combated or have followed out this idea, and then dismissed it. To the millionaire's matter-of-fact mind, it was a deduction that, having once presented itself to his perception, was already a recognized fact. For the first time in his life he felt a sudden instinct of something like aversion towards his family, a feeling that even his son's dissipation and criminality had never provoked. He hurried on angrily through the darkness. It was very strange; the old house should be almost before him now, across the hollow, yet there were no indications of light. It was not until he actually reached the garden fence, and the black bulk of shadow rose out against the sky, that he saw a faint ray of light from one of the lean-to windows. He went to the front door and knocked. After waiting in vain for a reply, he knocked again. The second knock proving equally futile, he tried the door; it was unlocked, and, pushing it open, he walked in. The narrow passage was quite dark, but from his knowledge of the house he knew the lean-to was next to the kitchen, and, passing through the dining room into it, he opened the door of the little room from which the light proceeded. It came from a single candle on a small table, and beside it, with his eyes moodily fixed on the dying embers of the fire, sat old Slynn. There was no other light nor another human being in the whole house. For the instant Mulready, forgetting his own feelings in the mute picture of the utter desolation of the helpless man, remained speechless on the threshold. Then, recalling himself, he stepped forward and laid his hand gaily on the bowed shoulders. "Rouse up out o' this, old man. Come. This won't do. Look. I've run over here in the rain, just to have a sociable time with you all." "I knew it," said the old man, without looking up, I knew you'd come. You knew I'd come, echoed Mulratty, with an uneasy return of the strange feeling of awe with which he regarded Slynn's abstraction. Yes, you were alone like myself, all alone. Then, why in thunder didn't you open the door or sing out just now, he said, with an affected brusquerie to cover his uneasiness. Where's your daughters? Gone to Rough and Ready to a party. And your son? He never comes here when he can amuse himself elsewhere. Your children might have stayed home on Christmas Eve. So might yours. He didn't say this impatiently, but with a certain abstracted conviction far beyond any suggestion of its being a retort. Mulratty did not appear to notice it. Well, I don't see why us old folks can't enjoy ourselves without them, said Mulratty, with affected cheerfulness. Let's have a good time, you and me. Let's see, you haven't anyone you can send to my house, HEVU. They took the servant with them, said Slynn, briefly. There is no one here. All right, said the millionaire, briskly. I'll go myself. Do you think you can manage to light up a little more, and build a fire in the kitchen while I'm gone? It used to be mighty comfortable in the old times. He helped the old man to rise from his chair, and seemed to have infused into him some of his own energy. He then added, Now, don't you get yourself down again into that chair until I come back, and darted out into the night once more. In a quarter of an hour he returned with a bag on his broad shoulders, which one of his porters would have shrunk from lifting, and laid it before the blazing hearth of the now lighted kitchen. It's something the old woman got for her party, that didn't come off, he said, apologetically. I reckon we can pick out enough for a spread. That darned Chinaman wouldn't come with me, he added, with a laugh, because, he said, he'd knocked off work all the same, Melican man. Look here, Slynn, he said, with a sudden decisiveness, my payroll of the men around here don't run short of $150 a day, and yet I couldn't get a hand to help me bring this truck over for my Christmas dinner. Of course, said Slynn, gloomily. Of course, so it oughter be, returned Mulratty, shortly. Why, it's only there one day out of 364, and I can have 363 days off, as I am their boss. I don't mind a man's being independent, he continued, taking off his coat and beginning to unpack his sack, a common gunny bag used for potatoes. We're independent ourselves, ain't we, Slynn? His good spirits, which had been at first labored and affected, had become natural. Slynn, looking at his brightened eye and fresher color, could not help thinking he was more like his own real self at this moment than in his counting house and offices with all his simplicity as a capitalist. A less abstracted and more observant critic than Slynn would have seen in this patient aptitude for real work, and the recognition of the force of petty detail, the dominance of the old market gardener in his former humble, as well as his later more ambitious, successes. Heaven keep us from being dependent upon our children, said Slynn, darkly. Let the young ones alone tonight, we can get along without them, as they can without us, said Mulratty, with a slight twinge as he thought of his reflections on the hillside. But look here, there's some champagne and them sweet cordials that women like, there's jellies and such like stuff, about as good as they make em, I reckon, and preserves, and tongues, and spiced beef, take your pick. Stop, let's spread them out. He dragged the table to the middle of the floor, and piled the provisions upon it. They certainly were not deficient in quality or quantity. Now, Slynn, wade in. I don't feel hungry, said the invalid, who had lapsed again into a chair before the fire. No more do I, said Mulratty, but I reckon it's the right thing to do about this time. Some folks think they can't be happy without their getting outside o' suthin', and my directors down at Frisco can't do any business without a dinner. Take some champagne, to begin with. He opened a bottle, and filled two tumblers. It's past 12 o'clock, old man, so here's a Merry Christmas to you, and both of us easy is here. And here's another to our families easy isn't. They both drank their wine stolidly. The rain beat against the windows sharply, but without the hollow echoes of the house on the hill. I must write to the old woman and Mamie, and say that you and me had a high old time on Christmas Eve. By ourselves, added the invalid. Mr. Mulratty coughed. Nat rally by ourselves. And her provisions, he added, with a laugh. We're really beholden to her for em. If she hadn't thought of having them for somebody else, you wouldn't have had them, would you? Said Slynn, slowly, gazing at the fire. No, said Mulratty, dubiously. After a pause he began more vivaciously, and as if to shake off some disagreeable thought that was impressing him, but I mustn't forget to give you your Christmas, old man, and I've got it right here with me. He took the folded envelope from his pocket, and, holding it in his hand with his elbow on the table, continued, I don't mind telling you what idea I had in giving you what I'm going to give you now. I've been thinking about it for a day or two. A man like you don't want money, you wouldn't spend it. A man like you don't want stocks or fancy investments, for you couldn't look after them. A man like you don't want diamonds and jewelry, nor a gold-headed cane, when it's got to be used as a crutch. No, sir. What you want is something that won't run away from you, that is always there before you and won't wear out, and will last after you're gone. That's land. And if it wasn't that I have sworn never to sell or give away this house and that garden, if it wasn't that I've held out agin the old woman and Mamie on that point, you should have this house and that garden. But, mebbe, for the same reason that I've told you, I want that land to keep for myself. But I've selected 4 acres of the hill this side of my shaft, and here's the deed of it. As soon as you're ready, I'll put you up a house as big as this that shall be yours, with the land, as long as you live, old man, and after that your children's. No, not theirs, broke in the old man, passionately. Never. Mulratty recoiled for an instant in alarm at the sudden and unexpected vehemence of his manner. Go slow, old man, go slow, he said, soothingly. Of course, you'll do with your own as you like. Then, as if changing the subject, he went on cheerfully, perhaps you'll wonder why I picked out that spot on the hillside. Well, first, because I reserved it after my strike in case the lead should run that way, but it didn't. Next, because when you first came here you seemed to like the prospect. You used to sit there looking at it, as if it reminded you of something. You never said it did. They say you was sitting on that boulder there when you had that last attack, you know, but, he added, gently, you've forgotten all about it. I have forgotten nothing, said Slynn, rising, with a choking voice. I wish to God I had, I wish to God I could. He was on his feet now, supporting himself by the table. The subtle generous liquor he had drunk had evidently shaken his self-control, and burst those voluntary bonds he had put upon himself for the last 6 months. The insidious stimulant had also put a strange vigor into his blood and nerves. His face was flushed, but not distorted. His eyes were brilliant, but not fixed. He looked as he might have looked to masters in his strength 3 years before on that very hillside. Listen to me, Alvin Mulratty, he said, leaning over him with burning eyes. Listen, while I have brain to think and strength to utter, why I have learned to distrust, fear, and hate them. You think you know my story? Well, hear the truth from me tonight, Alvin Mulratty, and do not wonder if I have cause. He stopped, and, with pathetic inefficiency, passed the fingers and inward-turned thumb of his paralyzed hand across his mouth, as if to calm himself. 3 years ago I was a miner, but not a miner like you. I had experience, I had scientific knowledge, I had a theory, and the patience and energy to carry it out. I selected a spot that had all the indications, made a tunnel, and, without aid, counsel or assistance of any kind, worked it for 6 months, without rest or cessation, and with scarcely food enough to sustain my body. Well, I made a strike, not like you, Mulratty, not a blunder of good luck, a fool's fortune there, I don't blame you for it, but in perfect demonstration of my theory, the reward of my labor. It was no pocket, but a vein, a lead, that I had regularly hunted down and found a fortune. I never knew how hard I had worked until that morning, I never knew what privations I had undergone until that moment of my success, when I found I could scarcely think or move. I staggered out into the open air. The only human soul near me was a disappointed prospector, a man named Masters, who had a tunnel not far away. I managed to conceal from him my good fortune and my feeble state, for I was suspicious of him of anyone, and as he was going away that day I thought I could keep my secret until he was gone. I was dizzy and confused, but I remember that I managed to write a letter to my wife, telling her of my good fortune, and begging her to come to me, and I remember that I saw Masters go. I don't remember anything else. They picked me up on the road, near that boulder, as you know. I know, said Mulratty, with a swift recollection of the stage driver's account of his discovery. They say, continued Slynn, tremblingly, that I never recovered my senses or consciousness for nearly 3 years, they say I lost my memory completely during my illness, and that by God's mercy, while I lay in that hospital, I knew no more than a babe, they say, because I could not speak or move, and only had my food as nature required it, that I was an imbecile, and that I never really came to my senses until after my son found me in the hospital. They say that, but I tell you tonight, Alvin Mulratty, he said, raising his voice to a hoarse outcry, I tell you that it is a lie. I came to my senses a week after I lay on that hospital cot, I kept my senses and memory ever after during the 3 years that I was there, until Harry brought his cold, hypocritical face to my bedside and recognized me. Do you understand? I, the possessor of millions, lay there a pauper. Deserted by wife and children, a spectacle for the curious, a sport for the doctors, and I knew it. I heard them speculate on the cause of my helplessness. I heard them talk of excesses and indulgences I, that never knew wine or woman. I heard a preacher speak of the finger of God, and point to me. May God curse him. Go slow, old man, go slow, said Mulratty, gently. I heard them speak of me as a friendless man, an outcast, a criminal, a being whom no one would claim. They were right, no one claimed me. The friends of others visited them, relations came and took away their kindred, a few lucky ones got well, a few, equally lucky, died. I alone lived on, uncared for, deserted. The first year, he went on more rapidly, I prayed for their coming. I looked for them every day. I never lost hope. I said to myself, she has not got my letter, but when the time passes she will be alarmed by my silence, and then she will come or send someone to seek me. A young student got interested in my case, and, by studying my eyes, thought that I was not entirely imbecile and unconscious. With the aid of an alphabet, he got me to spell my name and town in Illinois, and promised by signs to write to my family. But in an evil moment I told him of my cursed fortune, and in that moment I saw that he thought me a fool and an idiot. He went away, and I saw him no more. Yet I still hoped. I dreamed of their joy at finding me, and the reward that my wealth would give them. Perhaps I was a little weak still, perhaps a little flighty, too, at times, but I was quite happy that year, even in my disappointment, for I had still hope. He paused, and again composed his face with his paralyzed hand, but his manner had become less excited, and his voice was stronger. A change must have come over me the second year, for I only dreaded their coming now and finding me so altered. A horrible idea that they might, like the student, believe me crazy if I spoke of my fortune made me pray to God that they might not reach me until after I had regained my health and strength and found my fortune. When the third year found me still there, I no longer prayed for them, I cursed them. I swore to myself that they should never enjoy my wealth, but I wanted to live, and let them know I had it. I found myself getting stronger, but as I had no money, no friends, and nowhere to go, I concealed my real condition from the doctors, except to give them my name, and to try to get some little work to do to enable me to leave the hospital and seek my lost treasure. One day I found out by accident that it had been discovered. You understand, my treasure, that had cost me years of labor and my reason, had left me a helpless, forgotten pauper. That gold I had never enjoyed had been found and taken possession of by another. He checked an exclamation from Mulratty with his hand. They say they picked me up senseless from the floor, where I must have fallen when I heard the news. I don't remember. I recall nothing until I was confronted, nearly 3 weeks after, by my son, who had called at the hospital, as a reporter for a paper, and had accidentally discovered me through my name and appearance. He thought me crazy, or a fool. I didn't undeceive him. I did not tell him the story of the mine to excite his doubts and derision, or, worse, if I could bring proof to claim it, have it perhaps pass into his ungrateful hands. No, I said nothing. I let him bring me here. He could do no less, and common decency obliged him to do that. And what proof could you show of your claim? Asked Mulratty, gravely. If I had that letter, if I could find Masters, began Slynn, vaguely. Have you any idea where the letter is, or what has become of Masters? Continued Mulratty, with a matter-of-fact gravity, that seemed to increase Slynn's vagueness and excite his irritability. I don't know. I sometimes think he stopped, sat down again, and passed his hands across his forehead. I have seen the letter somewhere since. Yes, he went on, with sudden vehemence, I know it, I have seen it. His brows knitted, his features began to work convulsively, he suddenly brought his paralyzed hand down, partly opened, upon the table. I will remember where. Go slow, old man, go slow. You asked me once about my visions. Well, that is one of them. I remember a man somewhere showing me that letter. I have taken it from his hands and opened it, and knew it was mine by the specimens of gold that were in it. But where or when or what became of it, I cannot tell. It will come to me, it must come to me soon. He turned his eyes upon Mulratty, who was regarding him with an expression of grave curiosity, and said bitterly, "You think me crazy. I know it. It needed only this." "Where is this mine?" asked Mulratty, without heeding him. The old man's eyes swiftly sought the ground. "It is a secret, then?" "No." "You have spoken of it to anyone?" "No." "Not to the man who possesses it?" "No." "Why?" "Because I wouldn't take it from him."
"Why wouldn't you?"
"Because that man is yourself." In the instant of complete silence that followed, they could hear that the monotonous patter of rain on the roof had ceased. "Then all this was in my shaft, and the vein I thought I struck there was your lead, found 3 years ago in your tunnel."
"Is that your idea?"
"Yes."
"Then I don't sabe why you don't want to claim it."
"I have told you why I don't want it for my children. I go further, now, and I tell you, Alvin Mulratty, that I was willing that your children should squander it, as they were doing. It has only been a curse to me, it could only be a curse to them, but I thought you were happy in seeing it feed selfishness and vanity. You think me bitter and hard. Well, I should have left you in your fool's paradise, but that I saw tonight, when you came here, that your eyes had been opened like mine. You, the possessor of my wealth, my treasure, could not buy your children's loving care and company with your millions, any more than I could keep mine in my poverty. You were tonight lonely and forsaken, as I was. We were equal, for the first time in our lives. If that cursed gold had dropped down the shaft between us into the hell from which it sprang, we might have clasped hands like brothers across the chasm. Mulratty, who in a friendly show of being at his ease had not yet resumed his coat, rose in his shirt sleeves, and, standing before the hearth, straightened his square figure by drawing down his waistcoat on each side with two powerful thumbs. After a moment's contemplative survey of the floor between him and the speaker, he raised his eyes to Slynn. They were small and colorless, the forehead above them was low, and crowned with a shock of tawny reddish hair,
even the rude strength of his lower features was enfeebled by a long, straggling, goat-like beard, but for the first time in his life the whole face was impressed and transformed with a strong and simple dignity. "Easy far easy I can see, Slyn," he said, gravely, "the pint between you and me ain't to be settled by our children, or what we allow is due and right from them to us. Afore we preach at them for playing in the slum gullion, and getting themselves splashed, perhaps we mout easy well remember that our slum gullion comes from our own sluice boxes, where we wash our gold. So we'll just put them behind us, so," he continued, with a backward sweep of his powerful hand towards the chimney, and goes on. "The next thing that crops up ahead of us is your 3 years in the hospital, and what you went through at that time. I ain't saying it wasn't rough on you, and that you didn't have it about as big as it's made, but easy you'll allow that you'd HEV had that for 3 years, whether I'd found your mine or whether I hadn't, I think we can put that behind us, too. There's nothing now left to prospect but your story of your strike. Well, take your own proofs. Masters is not here, and if he was, according to your own story, he knows nothing of your strike that day, and could only prove you were a disappointed prospector in a tunnel, your letter that the person you wrote to never got you can't produce, and if you did, would be only your own story without proof. There is not a businessman easy would look at your claim, there isn't a friend of yours that wouldn't believe you were crazy, and dreamed it all, there isn't a rival of yours easy wouldn't say easy you'd invented it. Slyn, I'm a businessman, I am your friend, I am your rival, but I don't think you're lying, I don't think you're crazy, and I'm not sure your claim ain't a good one. If you reckon from that I'm going to hand you over the mine tomorrow," he went on, after a pause, raising his hand with a deprecating gesture, "you're mistaken. For your own sake, and the sake of my wife and children, you've got to prove it more clearly than you HEV, but I promise you that from this night forward I will spare neither time nor money to help you to do it. I have more than doubled the amount that you would have had you taken the mine the day you came from the hospital. When you prove to me that your story is true and we will find some way to prove it, if it is true that amount will be yours at once, without the need of a word from law or lawyers. If you want my name to that in black and white, come to the office tomorrow, and you shall have it." "And you think I'll take it now," said the old man passionately. "Do you think that your charity will bring back my dead wife, the 3 years of my lost life, the love and respect of my children? Or do you think that your own wife and children, who deserted you in your wealth, will come back to you in your poverty? No. Let the mine stay, with its curse, where it is, I'll have none of it." "Go slow, old man, go slow," said Mulrady, quietly, putting on his coat. "You will take the mine if it is yours, if it isn't, I'll keep it. If it is yours, you will give your children a chance to show what they can do for you in your sudden prosperity, as I shall give mine a chance to show how they can stand reverse and disappointment. If my head is level and I reckon it is, they'll both pan out all right." He turned and opened the door. With a quick revulsion of feeling, Slyn suddenly seized Mulrady's hand between both of his own, and raised it to his lips. Mulrady smiled, disengaged his hand gently, and saying soothingly, "Go slow, old man, go slow," closed the door behind him, and passed out into the clear Christmas dawn. For the stars, with the exception of one that seemed to sparkle brightly over the shaft of his former fortunes, were slowly paling. A burden seemed to have fallen from his square shoulders as he stepped out sturdily into the morning air. He had already forgotten the lonely man behind him, for he was thinking only of his wife and daughter. And at the same moment they were thinking of him, and in their elaborate villa overlooking the blue Mediterranean at Cannes were discussing, in the event of Mamie's marriage with Prince Rosso e Negro, the possibility of Mr. Mulrady's paying $250,000, the gambling debts of that unfortunate but deeply conscientious nobleman. Chapter 6. When Alvin Mulrady re-entered his own house, he no longer noticed its loneliness. Whether the events of the last few hours had driven it from his mind, or whether his late reflections had repeopled it with his family under pleasanter auspices, it would be difficult to determine. Destitute as he was of imagination, and matter of fact in his judgments, he realized his new situation as calmly as he would have considered any business proposition. While he was decided to act upon his moral convictions purely, he was prepared to submit the facts of Slynn's claim to the usual patient and laborious investigation of his practical mind. It was the least he could do to justify the ready and almost superstitious assent he had given to Slynn's story. When he had made a few memoranda at his desk by the growing light, he again took the key of the attic, and ascended to the loft that held the tangible memories of his past life. If he was still under the influence of his reflections, it was with very different sensations that he now regarded them. Was it possible that these ashes might be warmed again, and these scattered embers rekindled? His practical sense said no. Whatever his wish might have been. A sudden chill came over him, he began to realize the terrible change that was probable, more by the impossibility of his accepting the old order of things than by his voluntarily abandoning the new. His wife and children would never submit. They would go away from this place, far away, where no reminiscence of either former wealth or former poverty could obtrude itself upon them. His Mamie should never go back to the cabin, since desecrated by Slynn's daughters, and take their places. No. Why should she, because of the half-sick, half-crazy dreams of an old vindictive man? He stopped suddenly. In moodily turning over a heap of mining clothing, blankets, and India rubber boots, he had come upon an old pickaxe, the one he had found in the shaft, the one he had carefully preserved for a year, and then forgotten. Why had he not remembered it before? He was frightened, not only at this sudden resurrection of the proof he was seeking, but at his own fateful forgetfulness. Why had he never thought of this when Slynn was speaking? A sense of shame, as if he had voluntarily withheld it from the wronged man, swept over him. He was turning away, when he was again startled. This time it was by a voice from below, a voice calling him, Slynn's voice. How had the crippled man got here so soon, and what did he want? He hurriedly laid aside the pick, which, in his first impulse, he had taken to the door of the loft with him, and descended the stairs. The old man was standing at the door of his office awaiting him. As Mulratty approached, he trembled violently, and clung to the doorpost for support. I had to come over, Mulratty, he said, in a choked voice. I could stand it there no longer. I've come to beg you to forget all that I have said, to drive all thought of what passed between us last night out of your head and mine forever. I've come to ask you to swear with me that neither of us will ever speak of this again forever. It is not worth the happiness I have had in your friendship for the last half year, it is not worth the agony I have suffered in its loss in the last half hour. Mulratty grasped his outstretched hand. Perhaps, he said, gravely, there mayn't be any use for another word, if you can answer one now. Come with me. No matter, he added, as Slynn moved with difficulty, I will help you. He half supported, half lifted the paralyzed man up the three flights of stairs, and opened the door of the loft. The pick was leaning against the wall, where he had left it. Look around, and see if you recognize anything. The old man's eyes fell upon the implement in a half-frightened way, and then lifted themselves interrogatively to Mulratty's face. Do you know that pick? Slynn raised it in his trembling hands. I think I do, and yet. Slynn, is it yours? No, he said hurriedly. Then what makes you think you know it? It has a short handle like one I've seen. And isn't yours? No. The handle of mine was broken and spliced. I was too poor to buy a new one. Then you say that this pick which I found in my shaft is not yours? Yes. Slynn. The old man passed his hand across his forehead, looked at Mulratty, and dropped his eyes. It is not mine, he said simply. That will do, said Mulratty, gravely. And you will not speak of this again, said the old man, timidly. I promise you not until I have some more evidence. He kept his word, but not before he had extorted from Slynn as full a description of Masters as his imperfect memory and still more imperfect knowledge of his former neighbor could furnish. He placed this, with a large sum of money and the promise of a still larger reward, in the hands of a trustworthy agent. When this was done, he resumed his old relations with Slynn, with the exception that the domestic letters of Mrs. Mulratty and Mamie were no longer a subject of comment, and their bills no longer passed through his private secretary's hands. 3 months passed, the rainy season had ceased, the hillsides around Mulratty's shaft were bridal-like with flowers, indeed, there were rumors of an approaching fashionable marriage in the air, and vague hints in the record that the presence of a distinguished capitalist might soon be required abroad. The face of that distinguished man did not, however, reflect the gaiety of nature nor the anticipation of happiness. On the contrary, for the past few weeks, he had appeared disturbed and anxious, and that rude tranquility which had characterized him was wanting. People shook their heads, a few suggested speculations, all agreed on extravagance. One morning, after office hours, Slynn, who had been watching the careworn face of his employer, suddenly rose and limped to his side. "We promised each other," he said, in a voice trembling with emotion, "never to allude to our talk of Christmas Eve again unless we had other proofs of what I told you then. We have none, I don't believe we'll ever have any more. I don't care if we ever do, and I break that promise now because I cannot bear to see you unhappy and know that this is the cause." Mulratty made a motion of deprecation, but the old man continued. "You are unhappy, Alvin Mulratty. You are unhappy because you want to give your daughter a dowry of $250,000, and you will not use the fortune that you think may be mine." "Who's been talking about a dowry?" asked Mulratty, with an angry flush. "Don Cesar Alvarado told my daughter." "Then that is why he has thrown off on me since he returned," said Mulratty, with sudden small malevolence, just that he might unload his gossip because Mamie wouldn't have him. "The old woman was right in warning me agin him. The outburst was so unlike him, and so dwarfed his large though common nature with its littleness, that it was easy to detect its feminine origin, although it filled Slynn with vague alarm." "Never mind him," said the old man, hastily, "what I wanted to say now is that I abandon everything to you and yours. There are no proofs, there never will be any more than what we know, than what we have tested and found wanting. I swear to you that, except to show you that I have not lied and am not crazy, I would destroy them on their way to your hands. Keep the money, and spend it as you will. Make your daughter happy, and, through her, yourself. You have made me happy through your liberality, don't make me suffer through your privation." "I tell you what, old man," said Mulratty, rising to his feet, with an awkward mingling of frankness and shame in his manner and accent, "I should like to pay that money for Mamie, and let her be a princess, if it would make her happy. I should like to shut the lantern jaws of that Don Cesar, who'd be too glad if anything happened to break off Mamie's match. But I shouldn't touch that capital unless you'd lend it to me. If you'll take a note from me, payable if the property ever becomes yours, I'd thank you. A mortgage on the old house and garden, and the lands I bought of Don Cesar, outside the mine, will screen you. If that pleases you," said the old man, with a smile, "have your way, and if I tear up the note, it does not concern you." It did please the distinguished capitalist of Rough and Ready, for the next few days his face wore a brightened expression, and he seemed to have recovered his old tranquility. There was, in fact, a slight touch of consequence in his manner, the first ostentation he had ever indulged in, when he was informed one morning at his private office that Don Cesar Alvarado was in the counting house, desiring a few moments' conference. "Tell him to come in," said Mulratty, shortly. The door opened upon Don Cesar erect, sallow, and grave. Mulratty had not seen him since his return from Europe, and even his inexperienced eyes were struck with the undeniable ease and grace with which the young Spanish-American had assimilated the style and fashion of an older civilization. It seemed rather as if he had returned to a familiar condition than adopted a new one. "Take a chair," said Mulratty. The young man looked at Slynn with quietly persistent significance. "You can talk all the same," said Mulratty, accepting the significance. "He's my private secretary. It seems that for that reason we might choose another moment for our conversation," returned Don Caesar, haughtily. "Do I understand you cannot see me now?" Mulratty hesitated. He had always revered and recognized a certain social superiority in Don Ramon Alvarado, somehow his son, a young man of half his age, and once a possible son-in-law, appeared to claim that recognition also. He rose, without a word, and preceded Don Caesar upstairs into the drawing room. The alien portrait on the wall seemed to evidently take sides with Don Caesar, as against the common intruder, Mulratty. "I hope the Senora Mulratty might have saved me this interview," said the young man, stiffly, "or at least have given you some intimation of the reason why I seek it. As you just now proposed my talking to you in the presence of the unfortunate Senor Eslin himself, it appears she has not. I don't know what you're driving at, or what Mrs. Mulratty's got to do with Slynn or you," said Mulratty, in angry uneasiness. "Do I understand," said Don Caesar, sternly, "that Senora Mulratty has not told you that I entrusted to her an important letter, belonging to Senor Eslin, which I had the honor to discover in the wood 6 months ago, and which she said she would refer to you?" "Letter," echoed Mulratty, slowly, "my wife had a letter of Slynn's." Don Caesar regarded the millionaire attentively. "It is as I feared," he said, gravely. "You do not know, or you would not have remained silent." He then briefly recounted the story of his finding Slynn's letter, his exhibition of it to the invalid, its disastrous effect upon him, and his innocent discovery of the contents. "I believed myself at that time on the eve of being allied with your family, Senor Mulratty," he said, haughtily, "and when I found myself in the possession of a secret which affected its integrity and good name, I did not choose to leave it in the helpless hands of its imbecile owner, or his sillier children, but proposed to trust it to the care of the Senora, that she and you might deal with it as became your honor and mine. I followed her to Paris, and gave her the letter there. She affected to laugh at any pretension of the writer, or any claim he might have on your bounty, but she kept the letter, and, I fear, destroyed it. You will understand, Senor Mulratty, that when I found that my attentions were no longer agreeable to your daughter, I had no longer the right to speak to you on the subject, nor could I, without misapprehension, force her to return it. I should have still kept the secret to myself, if I had not since my return here made the nearer acquaintance of Senor Eslin's daughters. I cannot present myself at his house, as a suitor for the hand of the Senorita Vashti, until I have asked his absolution for my complicity in the wrong that has been done to him. I cannot, as a caballero, do that without your permission. It is for that purpose I am here." It needed only this last blow to complete the humiliation that whitened Mulratty's face. But his eye was none the less clear and his voice none the less steady as he turned to Don Caesar. "You know perfectly the contents of that letter. I have kept a copy of it. Come with me." He preceded his visitor down the staircase and back into his private office. Slynn looked up at his employer's face in unrestrained anxiety. Mulratty sat down at his desk, wrote a few hurried lines, and rang a bell. A manager appeared from the counting room. "Send that to the bank." He wiped his pen as methodically as if he had not at that moment countermanded the order to pay his daughter's dowry, and turned quietly to Slynn. "Don Caesar Alvarado has found the letter you wrote your wife on the day you made your strike in the tunnel that is now my shaft. He gave the letter to Mrs. Mulratty, but he has kept a copy." Unheeding the frightened gesture of entreaty from Slynn, equally with the unfeigned astonishment of Don Caesar, who was entirely unprepared for this revelation of Mulratty's and Slynn's confidences, he continued, "He has brought the copy with him. I reckon it would be only square for you to compare it with what you remember of the original." In obedience to a gesture from Mulratty, Don Caesar mechanically took from his pocket a folded paper, and handed it to the paralytic. But Slynn's trembling fingers could scarcely unfold the paper, and as his eyes fell upon its contents, His convulsive lips could not articulate a word. "Perhaps I'd better read it for you," said Mulratty, gently. "You can follow me and stop me when I go wrong." He took the paper, and, in dead silence, read as follows. "Dear wife, I've just struck gold in my tunnel, and you must get ready to come here with the children, at once. It was after 6 months' hard work, and I'm so weak I. It's a fortune for us all. We should be rich even if it were only a branch vein dipping west towards the next tunnel, instead of dipping east, according to my theory." "Stop," said Slynn, in a voice that shook the room. Mulratty looked up. "It's wrong, ain't it?" he asked, anxiously. "It should be east towards the next tunnel." "No. It's right." "I am wrong. We're all wrong." Slynn had risen to his feet, erect and inspired. "Don't you see," he almost screamed, with passionate vehemence, "it's master's abandoned tunnel your shaft has struck. Not mine. It was master's pick you found. I know it now." "And your own tunnel," said Mulratty, springing to his feet in excitement. "And your strike is still there." The next instant, and before another question could be asked, Slynn had darted from the room. In the exaltation of that supreme discovery, he regained the full control of his mind and body. Mulratty and Don Caesar, no less excited, followed him precipitately, and with difficulty kept up with his feverish speed. Their way lay along the base of the hill below Mulratty's shaft, and on a line with Master's abandoned tunnel. Only once he stopped to snatch a pick from the hand of an astonished Chinaman at work in a ditch, as he still kept on his way, a quarter of a mile beyond the shaft. Here he stopped before a jagged hole in the hillside. Bared to the sky and air, the very openness of its abandonment, its unpropitious position, and distance from the strike in Mulratty's shaft had no doubt preserved its integrity from wayfarer or prospector. "You can't go in there alone, and without a light," said Mulratty, laying his hand on the arm of the excited man. "Let me get more help and proper tools. I know every step in the dark as in the daylight," returned Slynn, struggling. "Let me go, while I have yet strength and reason. Stand aside." He broke from them, and the next moment was swallowed up in the yawning blackness. They waited with bated breath until, after a seeming eternity of night and silence, they heard his returning footsteps, and ran forward to meet him. As he was carrying something clasped to his breast, they supported him to the opening. But at the same moment the object of his search and his burden, a misshapen wedge of gold and quartz, dropped with him, and both fell together with equal immobility to the ground. He had still strength to turn his fading eyes to the other millionaire of Rough and Ready, who leaned over him. "You see," he gasped, brokenly, "I was not crazy." No. He was dead.